Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Building Boys, Raising Great Guys in a World That Misunderstands Males, by Jennifer L. W. Fink, narrated by Emily Sutton-Smith. Introduction. You know what kind of boy you don't want to raise. You don't want to raise a sexual predator or mass shooter. You do not want to raise a man who takes advantage of others, unleashes his anger and frustration onto innocent victims, or is so enamored with his own talent, success, or perceived rightful place in society that he doesn't even realize or admit that his behavior is problematic. You want to raise a decent human, a boy-turned-man who is kind, steadfast, strong, persistent, and hardworking. The question is, how? How do we raise confident and secure boys in a world that often paints masculinity in a negative light? How do we teach boys to consider others' needs when their own needs are so often ignored? How do we advocate for our sons when doing so is considered, in some quarters anyway, an attempt to preserve male dominance? How do we help our boys navigate evolving gender norms while we adults are still unpacking the ways in which gender influences our lives? When my sons were born, no one told me about the challenges they'd face in school. No one told me that boys are affected by gender stereotypes and expectations, or that male development proceeds at a different pace than female development. Naively, I thought that I could parent a child irrespective of gender. I didn't think that parenting a boy would be significantly different than parenting a girl or non-binary child. I thought I could raise great guys by letting them play with whatever they wanted. Within reason, of course. No unsupervised chainsaw juggling here. And supporting their growth and development. If only it were that simple. I've since learned that ignoring or overlooking a child's gender is as unhelpful as ignoring a child's race, because gender, like race, impacts an individual's experience of the world. Gender, like race, affects an individual's self-perception, as well as how other people view and interact with that individual. Neglecting to consider or acknowledge this aspect of a child's experience can result in disconnection and misunderstanding. Most of you listening to this book are probably parents of cisgender boys who were born with a penis and testicles and never questioned their gender. You may believe that boys are biologically predisposed to wrestling and trucks rather than tea parties and dolls, and there's some evidence to suggest that you're right. Some research studies, for instance, have found that male infants prefer to look at moving objects, whereas female infants prefer to gaze at human faces. And other studies have found that male primates are more likely than females to engage in rough-and-tumble play. But other research studies note that the differences between males and females are small and not particularly significant. And careful analyses have found that many of the studies that noted differences included only a small number of subjects. Frankly, after 2 decades of parenting boys, I've concluded that it doesn't really matter why many boys prefer trucks to tea parties or are more likely than their female counterparts to get in trouble in school. Practically speaking, what matters is the reality that's unfolding before us. Academic discussions of nature versus nurture were not helpful to me when my 5-year-old son told me he hated school, or when my 12-year-old got in trouble for misbehaving in the boys' bathroom. In the trenches, parents of boys need information and tools that will help them understand and respond to their son's behavior and experiences in the world. That's what this book is, a map and a guide. It introduces you to the landscape you'll be navigating throughout your son's childhood and provide you with guidelines you can use to shepherd his development. You want to raise a great guy. I'm going to show you how. It's so easy to get lost in the details of parenting. What do I do when my son won't stop bickering with his brother? When he refuses to go to school? When he's in danger of failing because he has 32 missing assignments? It is exhausting to research each problem as it arises and evaluate and select alternatives. Exhausting. It is much easier and ultimately more productive to instead use a set of guidelines to direct your parenting choices. I've distilled 20-plus years of experience infused by decades of research regarding parenting and gender into 10 basic guidelines. 1. Learn the terrain. 2. Emphasize emotional intelligence. 3. Discuss and demonstrate healthy relationships. 4. Let him struggle. 5. Help him find and develop his talents. 6. Give him time. 7. Challenge him with chores and caregiving. 8. Keep him close. 9. Connect him to the real world. 10. Accept him as he is. These guidelines are the backbone of this book. Each guideline is the theme and focus of one chapter, and each chapter shows you how and why to apply the guideline to a variety of common parenting challenges. Because these guidelines are broad, they're applicable to boys of all ages and abilities. Ready? Let's begin. Here's to building boys. 1. Learn the terrain. How dreadful to be caught up in a game and have no idea of the rules. Caroline Stevermer, Sorcery and Cecilia, or The Enchanted Chocolate Pot. My son had been in school for only a few weeks when I received the note. Tyler drew a disturbing picture, the note began. My brain immediately conjured horrible, violent images. Stick figure people pointing crude guns at other stick figures who lay bleeding upon the floor. A person stabbing another, internal organs dripping out of the gaping hole. I brought my attention back to the note. Of an animal killing a human, it said. My brain adjusted the images in my head. A lion mauling a helpless person and feasting on their innards. Before going any further, I should tell you that I was a good girl. I was, and am, a rule follower and a people pleaser. I got good grades in school because I followed directions and did what I was told, and it never occurred to me to do otherwise. Like all good students, I believed that success in school was necessary for success in life. That was BB, before boys. Before I had had four sons who challenged my perceptions and introduced me to the nuances of human behavior. Before I understood that the male experience of the world is very different from the female one. Before I got the note. Ashamed and embarrassed by the trouble my son created so soon after starting school, I fired off an email to his teacher. "Thank you for letting me know. I will certainly talk to Tyler." Then I realized I didn't really know what he'd done. I added one more line to my email. "Can you tell me a little more about the drawing?" Soon I learned that my son drew an image of a shark attacking a surfer. A shark attacking a surfer. An image that's an integral part of countless movies, TV shows, and news reports. The disturbing image created by my son was nothing more than a fantastical depiction of an occasional real-world event. This was cause for a note from a teacher? Tyler was 10 years old at the time. He'd only recently started public school. Previously, I'd homeschooled him and his brothers. We'd pulled his oldest brother out of school halfway through first grade after realizing that school plus homework didn't leave much time for kids to spend with their families or pursue their own interests and passions. Nathan, my oldest, spent most of his first weeks of homeschool tracing pictures of guns from a book about weapons he'd borrowed from the library. Was I concerned? You bet. Even then, I was acutely aware of the fact that nearly every mass shooting has been committed by young males. Surely an obsession with guns was problematic, to say the least. Yet when I looked more closely, I realized that Nathan's interest in guns was primarily historical and mechanical. He noticed the details that differentiated a gun from the 1850s from one from 1945, and learned to sort weapons into their approximate era based on appearance alone. He grew curious about American wars and devoured books about the Civil War and World War II, and I relaxed a bit. Maybe my child wasn't a school shooter in training. Maybe he was a history buff, a 6-year-old who was building his fine motor skills by tracing photographs of weapons instead of writing sentences. I knew that Nathan could not have followed this path to learning in school. Few, if any, teachers are going to allow a first-grade boy to trace weapons in lieu of practicing his penmanship. Most schools have a zero-tolerance policy for weaponry, and those policies are rooted firmly in educators' desire to protect children. At the time, though, I didn't realize that zero-tolerance policies and a high level of suspicion for violent thoughts and behavior disproportionately affect young boys. I didn't understand that those policies squelch the development and imagination of many boys and contribute to their hatred of school. I also didn't realize that my sons weren't anomalies. I didn't know then that nearly all parents of boys have received at least one note, phone call, or email about an upsetting, disturbing, or inappropriate drawing or story their son crafted. Jamie Kasman was startled when her son's kindergarten teacher shoved a piece of paper in her hand and said, "I think you should see what your son drew." The drawing, scrawled in blue marker on lined, loose-leaf paper, featured a phallic-looking shape atop a vaguely heart-shaped, somewhat circular blob. The tip of the phallic shape was colored in and included a smiley face. Jamie asked her son to tell her about the picture. His response? "It's a heart man." Stacy Hensley's son was also 5 when she got her first phone call, informing her that her 5-year-old son used the F word in class. "I was shocked because my husband and I had been very careful not to use that word," Stacy says. When she asked her son about the incident, it became clear that he had no idea what the word meant or why everyone was upset. They were working on rhyming words at school, and duck was the word he was trying to rhyme. After he went through luck and truck, he started at the beginning of the alphabet and kept going to try to find rhyming words. He got to F, said the word, and moved on. "He had no clue why the school called me," Stacy says. Christine Prescott, an Australia-based mom, was notified that her then 5-year-old son needed to serve a detention because he and a friend were trying to figure out how to spell swear words during art class. "The boys didn't even really know what the words meant," she says. Note, in each of these instances, the boys were actively learning. Jamie's son expressed his creativity and basic knowledge of the heart. Stacy's son was engaged fully in his rhyming assignment. Christine's son and his friend were practicing spelling. And my son, Tyler, the one who drew the disturbing image of a shark attacking a surfer? He's always loved big, powerful beasts. At age 4, he was obsessed with dinosaurs, T-Rexes in particular. For a while, his best friend was an inflatable 6-foot dino. Like the rest of our family, he watched a lot of science documentaries. When I asked him about his drawing, he said, "That's what you get for letting me watch Shark Week." Of course, I explained to Tyler that violent drawings weren't okay in school, just as I'm sure Christine, Stacy, and Jamie explained to their sons that certain words and images aren't welcome in public settings. That's an essential lesson for our sons. But it also strikes me that each of these boys was reprimanded early in their school career for creative expression that was misinterpreted and misunderstood by educators. All too often, boys' early school experiences are marked by reprimands, phone calls, and notes about troublesome or inappropriate behavior, rather than by accolades or positive comments. And it's noteworthy, I think, that even though such phone calls and notes are a nearly universal experience for boys and their families, that fact isn't widely known. No one warns first-time boy parents about the pitfalls our boys often encounter in school and society. So most of us stumble headlong into these issues beside our sons. We then blame ourselves for the challenges we encounter without realizing that there are systemic factors at work. We're so embarrassed and ashamed because we so want to raise good guys and feel we've failed when our boys fall short of the great guy mark that we don't even realize that other boy parents are struggling with the same issues. It's time to stop stumbling alone in the dark. I'm here to hand you a map, flashlight, and emergency signaling device. Map of Male Development. Biologically speaking, humans of all genders are more alike than different. We all have hearts, brains, and hormones. And even though testosterone is frequently described as a male hormone and estrogen as a female hormone, all humans have a bit of both. Certainly, the proportion of hormones flowing through our bodies varies, as does the overall size and makeup of our adult bodies. The much-publicized differences between so-called male and female brains haven't held up under closer examination. Yes, the brains of adult males are larger, on average, than the brains of adult females. But that's likely because men are larger, on average, than women. Male development, though, proceeds at a different pace than female development. At birth, male infants are typically less developed than their female counterparts. According to a seminal 1972 text, newborn baby girls are developmentally similar to 4 to 6 week old baby boys. A 2007 study reported that newborn girls are better able to mimic fine motor movements, and multiple studies have revealed that male infants exhibit greater emotional reactivity than female infants. Boy babies tend to be fussier than their female counterparts and need more help than female babies to calm down. In the words of a 2002 academic paper, 6-month-old male infants are less able than females to physiologically regulate frustration. In plain language, this means that, generally speaking, boy babies require external assistance to settle when their brains and bodies become overwhelmed. That's why holding your baby boy to your chest and swaying back and forth is so effective. With his head against your ribcage, he can hear your heart and feel your breath, and his body gradually adjusts his heart and respiratory rate to match yours. By the time an infant is approximately 3 months of age, simply sharing a loving look may be sufficient to sync his heartbeat to yours. But here's the catch. Because males are less mature and more emotionally reactive at birth, and because generations-old gender norms tell us that boys are tough, parents are less likely to gaze lovingly at male infants and engage them in conversation, which means that boy babies may continue to have a hard time settling down. Continued fussing and crying stresses exhausted and overwhelmed parents, who are then less likely to reply with empathy and understanding, and a vicious cycle of misunderstanding and unmet needs begins. From the earliest days of life, boys are more likely than girls to need support and assistance, and less likely to receive it. This pattern is inadvertently repeated throughout boys' lives. By the time children reach the tween years, approximately ages 8 through 12, boys are about 2 years behind girls in the development of social sensitivity, or the ability to perceive, understand, and respect the feelings and viewpoints of others. On average, the parts of the brain that handle language, that help children read and write, mature 6 years later in boys than in girls. Brain maturation follows the same trajectory in both males and females, but boys' brains take longer to reach the same point of development. Alan N. Shore, an American psychologist whose research has focused on neuropsychiatry, developmental psychology, infant mental health and behavioral biology, has written that there are different maturational rates in brain growth that suggests separate norms for each gender. These norms need to reflect normal gender differences in slow-maturing male versus fast-maturing female infants' socio-emotional functions. That, of course, is not the case in modern society. In part because many adults are loath to admit any differences between males and females, boys and girls are held to the same standards throughout childhood. 3- and 4-year-old boys and girls are expected to maintain the same levels of attention and self-control in preschool. Even though boys are developmentally less able to control and regulate their emotions at that point, which may explain why preschool boys are expelled at a rate of more than 4.5 times that of girls. In elementary school, boys, girls, and non-binary children are now expected to read and write basic sentences in kindergarten, even though the parts of the brain that handle language are not nearly as mature in 5- and 6-year-old boys as they are in similarly aged girls. And because boys' emotional control and impulse regulation lag behind girls, because their brains take longer to reach the same level of maturity, elementary school boys, on average, struggle more in typical classroom settings than their female peers. A 2018 study found that in almost every public school system, girls came out ahead on reading scores, regardless of socioeconomic status or race. In third grade, females outperform males by about 0.5 grade level. By the end of eighth grade, girls are almost a full grade ahead. Further complicating matters is the fact that males are also more vulnerable than females to all kinds of physical and psychological stressors, including germs, pollution, and trauma. Boys' slower pace of brain maturation means that their developing brains are vulnerable to harm for a longer period than girls' brains, which can compound boys' disadvantage. In a 2000 paper published in the prestigious medical journal BMJ, Sebastian Kramer, a child and adolescent psychiatrist, writes that early environmental stressors could lead to disadvantage for boys being wired in. Experts believe that this interaction of environment and biology may explain, at least in part, why boys are more likely than girls to exhibit neurodevelopmental disorders, such as autism spectrum disorder, ASD, and attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD. Conditions such as these further inhibit brain development. According to Ryan Wexelblatt, a.k.a. ADHD Dude, a licensed clinical social worker who specializes in ADHD, the development of the prefrontal cortex, the part of the brain that manages working memory and executive functioning, lags about 30% behind the rest of the brain in children with ADHD. So, a 12-year-old boy with ADHD may well act and behave like an immature 9-year-old, even if he sprouted facial hair and looks more like a young man than a young boy. Gender stereotypes set boundaries for boys and limit concern for their well-being. For millennia, the hegemonic myth has shaped human experience. The hegemonic myth is essentially the myth that says boys are strong and girls are weak, says Robert Blum, MD, MPH, PhD, a professor at Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health and the principal investigator of the Global Early Adolescence Study. That myth is believed in India. It's believed in the Congo. It's believed in New Orleans. It's believed everywhere. It's like someone has written a global script. That script has been internalized and even written into law in some places. And despite significant advances in gender equality over recent years, the hegemonic myth, that idea that males are and should be strong and dominant, shapes boys' behavior even today. Look at automotive fatalities, Dr. Blum says. Who dies in automotive fatalities? Boys and men die far more than women die. Why? Is this hormonal? Biologic? Absolutely not. It is behavioral. It has a lot to do with our gender norms, and a lot of it has to do with proving that I'm a man. Dr. Blum tells me that whenever he sees a car speeding down the highway, moving far faster than all the other vehicles on the road, he always looks to see if the driver is a woman or a man. Almost without exception, it's a man, he says. A memory from the night before pops into my head. A car full of teenage boys rounding the corner in the high school parking lot. The driver was going too fast and took the corner wide. The car hit the curb. All three males, two passengers and the driver, laughed hysterically. The driver slammed the car into reverse, backing up suddenly, and then abruptly jolted the car forward and peeled out of the parking lot. I was in that parking lot because I was leaving a high school soccer game. The moment stood out because, as a mom of teenage boys, I know that no mother wants to see her son driving like that. It wasn't until my conversation with Dr. Blum that I saw the subtext of the moment. A boy, ashamed and embarrassed in front of his friends, unable to deny evidence suggesting that he's not always a competent driver. But boys, males, are expected to be competent. Male weakness or vulnerability are not allowed under the hegemonic myth. So the driver responded according to script. He laughed it off as a joke, took risks, showed he was in control by going fast and acting cool. At that moment, asserting confidence was the only way for the male to save face in front of his peers. Is it remarkable, then, that the statistics say that men are more likely to die in vehicular accidents? Is it remarkable that men are more likely to die from guns than are women? Dr. Blum asks. This is the natural consequences of our beliefs. These beliefs, based in society and culture rather than in biology, limit our sons' experiences, just as they do girls. Tony Porter, founder of A Call to Men, popularized the term man box, based on the concept of the act like a man box, which was originated by Paul Kivel, co-founder of the Oakland Men's Project. The man box defines the boundaries of acceptable male behavior in most cultures. According to Porter's 2010 TED Talk, the man box says that men and boys are strong, tough, athletic, courageous, heterosexual. Therefore, they should not cry, openly express any emotion but anger, be like a girl, ask for help, refuse or turn down sex. That list is probably not shocking to you. You've seen these norms in movies, music, advertising, and family interactions throughout your life. You've also almost certainly seen pushback against these standards in recent years, calls from parents and others to allow boys the full range of emotional expression and to steer clear of phrases such as act like a man and stop crying. You may know boys who wear fingernail polish and dresses. And yet, parenting author Aaron Gouveia wrote his 2020 book, Raising Boys to Be Good Men, after his son was bullied for wearing fingernail polish to kindergarten. And the question of whether it's okay for boys to wear colorful paint on their fingernails or toenails remains a frequent topic of discussion in online parenting groups. In fact, in 2021, Gouveia's youngest son was also criticized for wearing nail polish to kindergarten, even though the boy opted for blue, which everyone knows is a boy color. A 2018 survey by Plan International USA, an independent development and humanitarian organization that advances girls' equality and children's rights, reported that one-third of boys believe that society expects them to hide their feelings when they are sad or frightened. Another one-third said that they believe society expects them to be tough and suck it up when confronted with difficult events and emotions. One in three boys also reported feeling pressured to dominate or be in charge of others. 82% of the boys had heard someone telling a boy he was acting like a girl, a phrase that is virtually always used in a derogatory manner. 40% of heterosexual boys aged 14 to 19 said that they feel pressure to hook up with a girl, and 62% hear sexual comments and jokes about girls at least weekly. Certainly, progress has been made. 2/3 of the surveyed boys do not feel pressured to hide their feelings or suck it up when the going gets tough. 2/3 do not feel the need to dominate. And yet, "you're acting like a girl" remains one of the most offensive charges one can levy against a boy, which clearly implies that A, boys and girls should act differently, and B, being a girl is much worse than being a boy. These gender stereotypes get in our heads and shape boy culture. In many places, boys earn status by adhering to traditional gender norms. That's why the teenage driver who hit the curb laughed and peeled out of the parking lot. If he'd expressed shame, embarrassment, or confusion, his social status might have suffered. He had something to prove. Gender stereotypes and the man box influence our perception of boys and men as well. A fascinating study published in the November 2020 edition of the journal Organizational Behavior and Human Decision Processes reported an international tendency toward gender bias in moral typecasting. Basically, a tendency to assume that males are perpetrators of harm and females are victims. The researchers presented a variety of scenarios. A senior surgeon bullies a surgical trainee to the point that the trainee develops depression and suicidal tendencies. An animated green triangle pokes an orange triangle, which reacts by whirling away. Coworkers are in line for lunch at a professional conference when coworker B drops a fork and bends over to pick it up, at which point coworker A says, "You must get a lot of practice doing that." To more than 3,000 research subjects in the United States, China, and Norway. Researchers deliberately obscured or switched the genders of the actors in each scenario and asked subjects who they perceived as the victim and perpetrator. Across every scenario, participants were more likely to assume that a harmed target was female. They also reported feeling more warmth toward the victims that they perceived as female. Additionally, they desired harsher punishments for male perpetrators and were more willing to forgive female perpetrators. These findings likely wouldn't surprise young boys who frequently claim that the teacher likes girls better. Child psychologists and authors Michael Thompson and Dan Kindlin highlighted humans' tendency to assume the worst about males in their seminal book, Raising Cain, Protecting the Emotional Life of Boys, more than 2 decades ago. They wrote, "Whatever else it means to be a boy in our culture, it means that your actions are more likely to be misinterpreted as threatening or disobedient, that you are more likely than the girl next door to be punished or treated harshly." Yet discussions of gender equity almost universally center women and girls, with little to no attention given to gender-linked harms suffered by boys and men. That, Dr. Blum says, is a mistake. There are those in the development community who believe fully that girls and women are vulnerable and need protection. They're right. Girls and women are vulnerable and need protection. But that does not mean that boys and men are not vulnerable and don't need protection, he says. We have perpetuated this notion that gender equality is about girls and women's protection, and that's a huge mistake, not because it's wrong, but because it's half the story. In a 2019 commentary published in the Journal of Adolescent Health, Dr. Blum and his co-authors note that boys and girls are harmed by gender norms. The evidence, the article states, indicates that both boys and girls are disadvantaged, some in similar and some in unique ways. The Global Early Adolescent Study pilot data suggest that boys experience as much disadvantage as girls, e.g., fear of being physically hurt, neglected, a victim of sexual or physical violence, and concludes that, To achieve gender equality, we need to redefine the problem as a gender, not a women's and girls issue, noting that an abundance of literature shows that males as well as females benefit from a more socially supportive climate. It is true that being male can be advantageous in some situations. It is not, however, a universal advantage. Gender-linked stereotypes limit boys' opportunities, colors others' perceptions of them, and shape boys' hopes and dreams. Jim DeVivo's son was about 7 years old when he asked his dad, "Why don't they ever say that boys can be anything they want to be?" Jim was startled. He'd grown up in an era in which girls' opportunities were limited, and boys, especially white boys, were encouraged to dream big. But he soon recognized the context of his son's question. "We're big Disney fans, and Disney Junior was the TV channel of choice. The boys watched the Tangled series, and Sophia the First, and Elena of Avalor, and Disney had a Dream Big Princess campaign. The commercial featured Disney princesses and all these girls in adventurous, active roles as scientists, explorers, athletes," Jim said. When Jim and his wife explained to their son that, not so long ago, laws explicitly stated that women and girls were not allowed to do things men and boys could, their son was surprised. His whole life he'd heard that girls and women could do anything. He saw that truth reflected in his TV shows, commercials, movies, and real-life interactions. What he hadn't heard, Jim realized, was anyone telling him that boys can do whatever they want. Spotlight on potential pitfalls. I didn't see the many ways in which gender affects boys' lives until I'd been a boy mom for nearly 4 years. When my first son was born, I didn't know that boys were falling behind girls academically, or that male students are far more likely than their female counterparts to be suspended or expelled. I didn't realize that the tween years are a time of tremendous transition and stress for boys and their families, and I definitely did not know that boys' brains do not fully mature until they're in their 20s. I didn't realize that massive misunderstandings regarding boys' needs and developmental trajectory underpinned most of their socialization. If I'd known any of that, I might have been more prepared when my bright son started telling me he hated school at age 5. I probably wouldn't have spent so much time crying as we navigated the tween years, and I would have proactively prepared for my boy's teen years. Instead, like most parents, I stumbled, unaware, into entirely predictable pitfalls. I don't want you to be as unprepared as I was, so I'm going to shine a light on the potential pitfalls that lie ahead. Starting school. According to the 6th Annual American Family Survey, 63% of parents think the United States education system caters well to girls, whereas 55% thinks it serves boys well. There's plenty of data to back up parents' perceptions that modern institutional education is, on the whole, more girl-friendly than boy-friendly. Boys make up about half of all preschool classes, but account for approximately 80% of preschool suspensions. As early as elementary school, boys are more likely than girls to be held back a grade, and boys are far more likely than girls to be identified by teachers as reading disabled. Although those stats may seem reasonable, after all, why wouldn't a school hold back elementary students who struggled with reading? They obscure two important contributing factors. 1, teacher bias, and 2, the slower pace of male development. A 2012 report from the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD, found that girls are more likely to receive better grades in school than boys in most countries and economies, even when boys and girls have similar reading performance and learning habits. The report further noted that many teachers reward class cooperation and penalize disruptiveness and disciplinary problems, which, again, may seem reasonable until you learn that additional research has shown that many teachers are prone to categorizing boys as disruptive and uncooperative. Lynn A. Barnett, PhD, an associate professor in the Department of Recreation, Sport, and Tourism at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, followed 278 children, boys and girls, from kindergarten to third grade, and identified degrees of playfulness among the children, while also noting student and teacher perceptions of individual students. She found that playful boys were regarded by kindergarten teachers as rebellious and intrusive. The boys were labeled class clowns and considered to have poor social skills. Although their classmates initially considered the playful boys fun and appealing playmates, they sensed their teachers' disapproval, and by third grade avoided the class clowns. Boys internalize these negative messages as well, and by third grade, many come to believe that school is not for them. Not helping matters is the fact that many young boys struggle to read and write and sit still because their brains and fine motor skills are not as mature as most females at ages 5 and 6. Developmentally, most young boys are asked and required to do things at school that their minds and bodies aren't mature enough to master. Boys whose early school experiences are marred by feelings of failure and frustration are not likely to become enthusiastic students. That's why I urge parents to carefully plan and monitor their sons' transitions to school and act quickly if problems emerge. Here's how. Avoid academically oriented preschools and elementary schools. Sounds crazy, right? After all, isn't academics the point of school? Unfortunately, that's the message we've been sold, and the consistent emphasis on standardized tests and scholastic achievement means that most schools do indeed emphasize academics, often at the expense of free play, even though reams of data and millennia of anecdotal experience show that boys and girls, and gender nonconforming children for that matter, learn best via active exploration. Teacher-led instruction is not the most effective means of learning for young children. Kids learn best via active exploration. So look for a play-based, child-led learning environment and steer clear of preschools and elementary schools that rely heavily on worksheets or screen-based instruction. Forest or nature schools, which utilize outside spaces and allow children to learn via their interaction with the natural environment, are a great alternative. Search online for forest school, nature school, or outdoor school. In fact, kids who struggle the most in traditional schools, wiggly kids who can't sit still or focus, often do well in nature. Ask about recess. Recess time has been dwindling for decades, and although there have been concentrated efforts in some parts of the country to restore and protect recess, since numerous studies have shown that recess benefits kids academically, socially, and physically, only 64.8% of U.S. school districts require that elementary schools offer regularly scheduled recess, according to the 2016 School Health Policies and Practices Study. Just 52% of districts prohibit or actively discourage schools from excluding students from all or part of recess as punishment for inappropriate behavior or failure to complete classwork, which means that many boys miss much-needed recess time. Look for a school that prioritizes recess, encourages free play, and doesn't consider recess a privilege that must be earned. Consider delaying your son's school entrance. Remember, boys' brains take longer to mature than girls' brains. Data also shows that kids who are comparatively young at school entrance may not fare as well as children who are a bit older. A study published in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2018 found that children with August birthdays were significantly more likely to be diagnosed with ADHD than kids with September birthdays in states that require children to be 5 years old by September 1st for enrollment in kindergarten. The rate of ADHD diagnosis was 34% higher for children with August birthdays, who are often nearly a full year younger than many of their same grade peers. Giving your son an additional year or so to mature may be one of the best gifts you ever give him. We'll talk more about the gift of time in Chapter 6. The tween years. Did you know that male puberty can start at age 9? Many parents of boys don't. I didn't. Which is one reason so many parents are overwhelmed, confused, and frustrated during their son's tween years. Our son's transition from sweet little boy who loves you more than you thought possible to mercurial human being who is annoyed by your mere presence can happen seemingly overnight. The tween years aren't easy for our sons, either. External pressure to live up to sexist stereotypes intensifies around puberty. According to a 2020 report by ProMundo and the Caring Foundation, boys ages 10 to 12 report feeling increased pressure to fit masculine stereotypes. Parents of boys see and sense their sons' struggles. Approximately 60% said they recognize the social pressures boys face to be physically strong, show interest in sports, and fit in. 45% said boys still face pressure not to cry. And 41% said boys are expected to have a girlfriend or to like girls romantically. Exposure to pornography is all but guaranteed. Yes, even if you use internet filters and install parental controls. A lackadaisical attitude toward school and formal education is de rigueur for tween boys. Academic effort is frowned upon in many social circles. Peer pressure increases, and boys will be exposed to vaping, alcohol, and drugs. Even if your son resists peer pressure, he may be affected by substance use. According to a 2021 Washington Post article by Jessica Leahy, author of The Addiction Inoculation, 29% of 12 to 14-year-olds say they have close friends who use substances. If you know that your son may pull away and show flashes of moodiness around age 10, you'll be much better prepared to navigate your son's tween years than most parents of boys. Expect some choppy waters during this stage of the journey. You won't be able to completely avoid the rapids and rocks, but you and your son have the best chance of coming through relatively unscathed if you pick your battles. Tween boys' brains are still developing. Your son's executive functioning, the cognitive skills used to assess risk, prioritize, and organize, won't mature until he's in his 20s. Tween boys are messy and disorganized because they're still developing self-control and because their priorities are not the same as yours. Welcome his friends. It's natural and normal for tween boys to want to spend more time with friends than family. So, as often as possible, say yes when he asks if his friends can come over. Stock up on snacks and keep your mouth shut when the boys crowd around one screen to watch a YouTuber play a video game. Continue to welcome his female friends, too. Mixed gender friendships can help tweens see one another as unique humans rather than potential sexual conquests. Prioritize mental health and stop stressing about school. According to Dr. Michelle Borba, author of Thrivers, The Surprising Reasons Why Some Kids Struggle and Others Shine, many boys are secretly stressed. The boys don't want to share their discomfort because they don't want to disappoint their parents, who often have emphasized academics and achievement, she says. Body dysmorphia, dissatisfaction with one's body, sometimes accompanied by an eating disorder or compulsion to exercise, can develop during the tween years. Chiseled and muscular is in, and absolutely ubiquitous on TikTok, Instagram, and youth-oriented TV shows. By age 6, most boys have internalized a desire to be muscular, and by the time males reach adolescence, nearly one-third of boys are trying to gain weight or bulk up. An overemphasis on academic and athletic achievement.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.